Would you like to accelerate your career and reach your full potential in just minutes a day? Welcome to the LEADx Show with New York Times bestselling author and Inc. 500 entrepreneur, Kevin Kruse.
What are six steps you can use to captivate your audience? Hello, everyone. Kevin Kruse here. And in just a minute, we're going to talk about how to move from informing to transforming any audience. But first, congratulations. You believe in lifelong learning. You believe that to achieve more, we must become more. You believe that leadership in all its forms is the key to making a difference, a key to making an impact. Whether you listen during your morning commute or maybe on your morning jog, you know that LEADx helps you to stand out and get ahead. LEADx is the smartest way to start your day. Today's 1 minute career tip is delegate to peers. Now, managers, of course, know they need to delegate certain tasks, but you should delegate even if you don't have your own team of people to manage. Just think of it as another way of asking for help. If I have to proofread the quarterly report this week, but I'm totally swamped or I'm just not very good at copy editing, I should try to reach out to a colleague, another team member, and ask for help. It's like time swapping. Hey, any chance you can review this report for the boss before Friday? I'd be happy to take something off your plate next week. Or, hey, our boss needs this report by Friday. I know you've got a better eye than I do. Any chance you can take it and I'll take over those Excel spreadsheets you're working on. In this time of feeling overworked and overwhelmed, one solution is to slow down long enough to optimize the workload. Just don't forget to let your boss know about it so she okays it before moving forward. Delegate to your peers. Our guest today is a leading communication expert, specifically in the area of how you can break through distractions to get your message heard. She has more than 15 years of corporate leadership experience, a Ph.D. in communication. She lectures at the Wharton School at the University of Pennsylvania. She's a best-selling author, and her new book is Getting a Squirrel to Focus on Presentations. Don't just inform, transform your audience. Our guest is Dr. Patricia Scott. Patricia, welcome to the show.
Thanks, Kevin.
So I always ask the same first question, and I know you're ready for it. I want our guests to share a time when they failed, maybe early in your career, because we want to know what you learned from it so we can learn from that failure too.
Sure. Well, I learned early on that if you want to be successful and advance, you have to learn to see the business as a whole and find your place in it. You have to take initiative if you want to be able to lead. I had, as most people, many odd jobs early in my career, and one of them was working at the deli counter at a local convenience store. It was actually a pretty good job. I was responsible for cutting lunch meat and making sandwiches and running the cash register. Well, one day it was slow. There were no people in the store. Nobody wanted a sandwich. So I sat behind the register and read a paper. Well, the boss comes storming out and asked me if I really wanted this job. I was shocked. Of course I did. He said to me, there's always something to do to help make us more successful. And then suggested I clean out the freezer, which was the worst job in the entire store. And as I was cleaning the freezer and it smelled bad and I was freezing, I thought to myself, I realized now that even though this is a small little business, he needed to be successful. And to do that, no one should ever just do their job. So if you want to be successful in advance, you have to learn to see the business as a whole and find your place in it. And needless to say, I was never inactive again. And I made sure I took initiative whenever I could.
Pat, I love this story. And it triggered a similar memory. My first job at a Carl's Jr. in Southern California, similar sort of thing of, you know, making the sodas, cleaning the salad bar. And probably on my first or second day there, at one point, I did everything that the boss had told me to do. So I was just sort of, and there were no customers in the restaurant at that time. So I was just sort of leaning against the counter and he comes out and goes crazy. Kruse, what are you doing? And I stand like, I don't know. What do you mean? He says, why are you standing there? I said, there's no customers. I did everything you told me to do. And he told me that there's always something to do. And he quickly showed me where the towels were, let me know that you could always wipe down the counters. You could always grab a mop or a broom. And I learned that lesson early on.
Yeah, and even though it was embarrassing at the time and I just didn't understand where he was coming from, I completely get it now.
Absolutely. So, Pat, getting a squirrel to focus on presentations. You say there's been a fundamental shift among audiences, and you know, if we're presenting facts, information, knowledge, we no longer have value. So what do you mean by that?
Yeah, Kevin, actually, there's been a huge shift in information and how we deal with it. It's changed a lot in the last decade or so. There's more information now than ever before. And of course, we all know that our attention spans are shorter than ever before. So I'll give you an example. When I was a kid and I needed some information, I'd actually have to get my mother to put me in a car and drive me to a library. And when I got to the library, I'm really not that old, but when I got to the library, I'd have to pull out the card catalog, walk my fingers through, find the book I wanted, give it to the reference librarian, because books that contained information were not allowed out of the library. So that librarian would have to go back to the stacks, copy it, give it to me. I'd get home and I'd realize, oh, I have the wrong article. Today, if I want something, I Google it. And if it says it will take 10 seconds to load, I think, oh my gosh, I might as well go get a snack, or I might as well check email. It seems like an eternity. We forget that just a short while ago, it would take longer than that for AOL to boot up. So we're so impatient now, and we want what we want when we want it. We're used to getting things that we want in very short amounts of time. So the way we process information is we want it quick, and we want what we want when we want it. We also know that we get instantly overwhelmed because there's so much more information. You know, at some point in our past, we had the Industrial Revolution. People made things. Then Peter Drucker, a management guru in the mid-1950s, said, no, you know, I think that's changing. We're not the Industrial Revolution anymore. Now we're all knowledge workers. Our productivity and what we do for a lot of people is that we have knowledge and we transfer it to someone else. And that was our power. I tell you, I worked for a medical device company for 13 years, and I was hired 3 months before we launched the division. And I made it my business to know more about the biomechanics, the competitive landscape, our products, the competitor, everything, than anyone else. And because of that, it gave me great power in the organization. If you needed to know something, you kind of had to find me. I knew every key opinion leader. I was in the OR more than everybody else. And that had great power. Today, that simply doesn't exist. We have so much information now that it's no longer scarce. And because it's no longer scarce, it no longer has the same value. So persuasion and sales were once based on information asymmetry. There was only one place to get the information, when the rep came in to visit you, or when the manager who knew a lot more or knew key opinion leaders. That's where the power came. Now we have information parity. I can look it up quicker than I can listen to you tell me. So what's scarce now is attention and engagement, and most of all, meaning. Because communication is the sharing of meaning, not the sharing of facts. So finding the so what for the audience is the value that we need to bring every time we present.
Okay, Pat, you hit so much good stuff here. And I want to follow up on this. Okay, so then how do we get to that so what? How do we transfer, how do we create meaning? But first of all, I squirmed in my chair as you talked about, you know, if something takes 10 seconds. And I swear I'm not making this up. Just yesterday, I discovered that I no longer have any high-speed connection on my phone because I share my plan with my children, and my son is at away camp this week where there is no Wi-Fi. So he's obviously been streaming some YouTube videos or something, and he ate up all our data. And so yesterday, I can't remember now, Pat, what I was trying to look up, but I went to look something up. And it's taking forever, which meant probably 3 seconds, 4 seconds. And I'm like, what is going on? And like, oh, shoot. Owen used up all of our data. This is probably going to take another 5 seconds. And I shut the browser window. Like, I didn't even want to wait the 5 seconds to get that information. And I think I'm a pretty, I know how to be a good learner and all the rest. And yet just yesterday, I did that very thing that you mentioned.
We find it so frustrating. It says your video content will load in 12 seconds. I'm like, oh my God, I don't want to wait till the ad is done. Come on.
That's right.
It's horrible.
That's right. And you talk about this information asymmetry, what old school sales was based on. And LEADx listeners, for the hardcore ones who have been with us from the start, you'll remember episode one with Dan Pink. And we talked about this idea of exactly what you said, Pat. You know, look, in the old days, the salesperson had the knowledge and that was an advantage and could be helpful. Now there's parity. And in my conversation with Dan Pink, we talked about in many cases, the buyer has more information than the seller.
Absolutely.
You know, if you're a salesperson, maybe you're selling 10 different computer systems or five different makes and models of cars, but the buyer who already has done her homework and kind of knows which vehicle or which computer, like they become the expert before they buy. So how do you add value? How do you communicate in a way that has impact, whether you're in sales or whether you're trying to lead your team or present to an audience? So Pat, I want to know, this idea of it's not just about conveying knowledge, just about conveying information. It's about meaning. And I know, because of course I've read your great book, you've got a 6-part acronym called WALNUT to go along with getting a squirrel to focus on presentations. So summarize the steps. How do we do it?
Well, the idea for WALNUT came to me one day. I'm looking out my office window and procrastinating because I didn't want to do whatever task was in front of me. And I'm watching the squirrels out in my yard. I thought, oh my gosh, look, those are my MBA students. And there's my husband, and there's my daughter. And they're all jumpy and sporadic and going all over the place. And then one of them picked up a nut and sat like a statue until it was done. And I thought, okay, well, a squirrel's attention span on normal things is about a second. This squirrel sat for 4 minutes with that nut until the thing was gone. I thought, that's exactly what we need to give our listeners. So I thought about that and came up with a 6-step process that will help you guide you through and think about when you're presenting data, how do you do it more effectively? Because I've sat in so many talks with my clients that, oh my gosh, they're just killing you. It's so hard to get through. We can't listen. They're not concise enough. So the WALNUT is an acronym for 6 different kind of buckets of tools. The W is for the what's in it for me. That's the WIFM. Now, it's an old concept, but it's never been more important. Because of all the information out there, we're better than ever at quickly deciding what to focus on, what's relevant, and what's in for me. And whatever is not in it for us or not relevant becomes noise, and we throw it away. So the statement of relevant helps the what we call the reticular activating system of the brain kick into gear and gets our attention. So without a statement of relevance, we have to quickly decide, is what I'm hearing going to help me or is it noise? And we have that remote control length attention span. And if I think, oh, I don't know what this is about, I click off and I think about something else. So if we play to that and really have a very strong WIFM to open, that helps get our attention and gets the process started. The A of the WALNUT is aligning your perspective. Communication, like I said before, is a sharing of meaning, not just facts. So if we have no context and are free to interpret facts on our own, we may not be clearly communicating what the message is that we want to get across. So by creating a frame early in the talk and putting everybody on the same page, we can increase our chances of actually sharing meaning. The L is limiting your scope. As we talked about, today's presenters are killing us. We just can't take that much in at one time. Studies have revealed that our working memory capacity is only about 3 or 4 chunks of information. So if we see an agenda slide at the beginning of your talk that has 12 items, we're instantly overwhelmed and give up and hope for a handout later. We don't try harder to listen. We just simply give up. The N is to navigate. We need to be deliberately led through the logic of the presentation. So often we know where we're going and how long it'll take there. We never share that information with our listeners. So we need a preview. We need to know where we're going and we need those milestones along the way. The transitions that are so easy to do yet people skip really help keep distracted audiences come with us. And they also, now we know from brain science, play a key role in how we make it easier to remember the stuff that's presented. So we need to help navigate that audience through. The U in the process is called unleash your creativity. Only at this point can you start to think about slides. You have to know your audience. You have to know what information. You have to know how to align them to your perspective. If you don't get that done and you just, like so many of my clients, I say, hey, we have a talk to do, and they open slide sorter and start pulling stuff in and then try to weave their story through it. Well, that's actually backward. You really have to figure out what you're there to say, what's meaningful and what they need to know, and then only show slides that support that. So long bulleted lists of stuff rarely help us understand things easier. So if you wait till later to start your slides, they tend to be more concise and do a better job for the audience. And then the final one is T, and that stands for take action. And take action is really kind of a twofold purpose. We just said a little bit ago, Kevin, that information has no value. So if you're the purpose of your talk is to inform your audience, really presentation is the wrong medium for that. You should just email it or podcast it or something where they could get it when they need it and make it more relevant for them as they need it. Presentation is the least effective way to transmit facts. So instead of informing your audience, we should always be persuading them. And if we're persuading them, then they'll take action. They'll be more engaged, and we want to hold them accountable. And we also need to take action as presenters. The slides that we create for our audiences are not the talk. We're the talk. So it's not enough to say, hey, you ready for your talk? They say, oh, yeah, Pat, got my slides done last night. Well, you're not nearly ready. We need to use every tool that we have to get this distracted audience to listen. We need to use our voice, our body, our facial expressions, and our eyes, anything else that we could throw at the message. So we do have to practice and make it an art form once again.
So much good stuff in there. And LEADx listeners, we don't have time to go through all of them, but some of the things that just jumped out at me, that very first W, the WIFM, what's in it for me? As you know, Pat said, we need to hook the audience right up front. And as I, you know, I do a talk every week or two. And so I am asked, you know, how do I, you know, do a speech or how to become a professional speaker? And one of the easiest things you can do to take your talk to the next level is make sure that your very first sentence is not, good morning, how are you? I'm excited to be here. How many people are awake? Some dumb joke about the coffee. Because just as Pat is saying, I mean, I've seen it, even with really strong presenters, when they do 20 seconds of hello or background, people pull out their phones, they're checking emails, they're scanning, they've already lost them. I mean, within seconds. And it feels odd, but I mean, when I am introduced and I take a stage, I open with the WIFM or WIFM in a form of a question. I don't say hello. I don't say good morning. I don't say thank you for that kind introduction. And if you think that's rude, you can always add that stuff at the very end before your rousing conclusion. You can always thank the organizers or thank the audience if you feel compelled to do it. But it's the simplest thing you can do that will make a huge difference is get that W, that WIFM done even before you say hello. And Pat, the one that I am fascinated by, but I also personally struggle with, is the A. So aligning your perspective, the framing. So go a little bit deeper. Maybe give me an example of something around this A concept.
Sure. We know that we cannot multitask. So that's a fact. As we learn more about the brain, we know it's physically impossible. We could do two things at the same time, but you can only actually focus on one thing at a time. And everything else becomes noise. So let's think of that in context of a talk. So when you put up a complex slide and it has data or charts or graphs on it, you're actually giving your audience a choice. You're forcing them to either look at the slide and try to figure it out on their own or listen to me explain it. And when given the choice, the audience will always defer to vision and try to figure it out on their own. Your visual cortex is way bigger than your audio cortex. So we're always going to defer to vision. So when I see a slide that's complex, the speaker's talking, but I'm looking at the slide trying to figure it out. I'm looking at the X and Y axes. I'm trying to figure out what the key message is. And what happens is it's a danger because they may not be looking at it the same way that you want them to see it because there's so many ways to interpret that slide. So You may be wanting to talk about the growth in Q3, but the audience in their mind is like, well, why are the units so low to begin with? So you're not aligned on the message and you're talking about the growth, but they're still thinking about that. So we get misunderstanding, and that's actually the cause of a lot of those horrible tangential questions you get that you're not expecting to talk about, right? Oh, wait, I'm here to talk about growth. Why are they picking on June, you know, and wondering about the unit difference? Or why are they wondering why that's in red? Like, people interpret it on their own. So by aligning the perspective with the audience, we really help avoid that. So to do that, we preview before they see the slide. So if I said something like, on the next slide, I'd like to show you a review of our sales for the last year, but I'd like you to pay particular attention to the orange bar in Q3 so that we could talk about our amazing growth. Now, if I click the slide, the audience will automatically begin looking at the orange bar in Q3 and interpreting everything I say about it in terms of growth. It's called framing. The concept, again, has been around a long time, and we do it a lot, you know, in other genres. Like, if you want to know if it's a horror movie, it's a frame. If I say, hey, I got to tell you this funny thing that happened last night, you stay with me for like 20 minutes thinking my story is going to get funny at some point until you realize I'm just not funny. Right? So you stay with me. That's framing. That's giving you a sense of where we're going so that everything you hear after, you start to interpret along those lines. It's very, very strong as a tool, but we never use it when we do slides. So if I tell you, I want you to look at Q3 and I want you to picture it as growth, people want to follow you. We want to be led communicationally. So if we can do that, it really makes a more targeted conversation and more engaging presentation.
Love that explanation. And, you know, I've spent a lot of days in angel investor rooms getting pitched by entrepreneurs, and almost like you were there, Pat, because they put up a slide and there's a lot on it and they don't really frame it at all. And all of a sudden, when they could be talking about that growth number or that growth rate or whatever it is, all the investors in the room start nitpicking on all these little things. And I've seen like all this positive momentum for 45 minutes get crushed because all of a sudden people are nitpicking on things and everybody's just got all these doubts and questions and the energy changes. And it would have been, now that I understand about aligning and framing, it would have been so easy for the entrepreneurs to just get our focus on what really mattered, what the key part of their message was. So that's very helpful.
Yeah, there's always room for questions later. But like you said, you don't want to ruin that momentum. You don't want them to go away thinking you were talking about something else. That frame could be so powerful. It's very easy to do.
So we have come almost to the end of our time. But before we wrap up, I always like to challenge our listeners to become just a little bit better every day. So, Pat, I want you to challenge us. What's one thing we can do today to become better as communicators?
Well, Kevin, I think that one of the most important things that we could do, not just as communicators, but as leaders in general, is to start to think of communication more as a strategic function and not just something we do every day. It's a very powerful tool if we use it well and if we give it some thought. You know, we say all the time, people are like, well, I told them, nothing happened. I told them. And then they say, well, you know what? I'm just going to tell them again. And I guess I'll have to tell them again. Well, that's because it's not working. We're not thinking about not just telling them, we're not just sharing information. How can we engage them? How can we make sure that they're transformed, not just informed? How can we make sure that we get at something that's relevant for them that they need so that they can really engage and find the so what, find the meaning in what we're trying to communicate? If we can start thinking that it, with any tool that you use, any of them, especially the WIFM is, I think, very helpful, but any of them, you just start thinking, okay, how am I actually going to address this audience? Who are they and what do they need? If we make it just that bit more strategic, I think we'll do a lot better as communicators.
Perfect. Patricia, thank you for coming on LEADx Show. How can our listeners find out more about you and your work?
Well, they can go to my website. It's www.ums.com. So www.ums.com, because I teach public speaking. So it's get that. Or they can look at either of my two best-selling books. The first one is Getting a Squirrel to Focus, Engage and Persuade Today's Listeners. Or my new one that we talked about today, Getting a Squirrel to Focus on Presentations. Don't just inform, transform your audience.
That's great. And it's funny, a little bit of backstory here, Pat. So I don't know if you're going to remember, but when I first heard of you years and years ago at this point, I was handed from someone else your business card. And I emailed you out of the blue and I said that your logo and calling your company UMS because you do, you know, speech coaching, communication skills. I thought that was genius. I don't know if you remember that very first email I sent you.
I absolutely remember that. I think I talked to you and told you that it was a little bit of a wine induced game, but it seems to work and it seems to, people remember it. So I think that's good.
It is so memorable. All right, friends, you've just been mentored in communication by Dr. Patricia Scott. Don't forget, you can get the links she just mentioned and the notes from this interview over at leadx.org. You can also download my free ebook, Richard Branson's 7 Secrets to Leadership, at leadx.org/Branson. And if you want to join our private ambassador group on Facebook, and why wouldn't you? We have tons of cool giveaways and stuff. Just leave a short review on iTunes. Hit me with an email to let me know, and we will send you an invite into the group. Until next time, remember, leadership is not a choice because it isn't about authority. It's about influence. You influence people when you speak up and you take action, but also you influence those around you with your silence when you choose to be a bystander. We are all leaders. How will you lead today?